mildly.
Somebody said I needed to give Nancy an extra 30 seconds since she got here late, but it's time to start. Man, what a blessing it is to be here today. It's the day after Christmas, but man, we just celebrate the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ every single day. And so I'm glad that you're here. I hope you've had a great time with your family yesterday or throughout the weekend. Our family is here with us today and glad to have them. And we're going to do our little celebration this afternoon. And it's just good to be with family, to be with friends, to be with a church family this morning as well. And so again, thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us. I hope you grabbed a bulletin on your way in. If not, please grab one on the way out. It gives you kind of what our schedule as a church and church family is going to be like throughout this holiday time with Christmas and New Year's, and the services are not having services. We won't have a Wednesday night service this coming week. So make note of all of those changes and different things that are there. This morning as well, last week we had our altar offering. Our goal for Lottie Moon Christmas offering was $5,500. And if you did pick up a bulletin and look on the very back of that, you see that right now we have taken up a total of $7,243.05. And so, man, that's awesome. You know, we have taken the goal that we had and just blew right on past that. And I think that is a wonderful, wonderful thing to do. We've also had another goal that we had earlier in the year for 750, I guess, or 700. What was our actual goal? 700, actually, Operation Christmas Shoe Boxes, Operation Christmas Child Shoe Boxes. And we passed, just blew on past that goal as well. But we also had a special guest who, as Miss Linda and some others went to pack some boxes this year, so we had a special guest that we had on Zoom, and he has a special just thank you that we want to share with you this morning. So for just a moment, if you'll look at the screen, and hopefully if this may be somebody you'll recognize.
Hey, Friendship Baptist. I am here at the Atlanta Processing Center with my friend Jana, Jamie, and Linda, and we are just excited to be serving. My name is Eve Dushima. In case you don't remember me, I received a shoebox when I was 11 years old, and we just wanted to look alive, people. Yay! We wanted to do a quick little shout out to you for the 808 shoeboxes that you filled and packed and sent with love, joy, and hope. And, you know, it only took 300 shoeboxes in my village for everything to change, for a witch doctor to come to know Christ, for people to get to hear the gospel. And I can only imagine what God is going to do around the world with your shoeboxes. So on behalf of my all my shoebox recipient friends, brothers and sisters out there, thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you do. God bless you. And I promise I will make it up to you someday. I know we missed out on a trip in Mississippi this past August. Mm-hmm. August it was. Mm-hmm. I was looking forward to it, but we're going to have to make up for it sometime, right?
Yes. Welcome to come anytime.
Yes. Awesome. So you guys have a wonderful holiday season. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
I think there's something special about Friendship Baptist Church. I love to set goals, but me, more importantly than just setting a few goals, I love when we just blow those goals out of the water. And the goal that we have of sharing Christ, the goal that we have of being like Christ, the goal that we have of being drawn closer to Him, I pray that each and every one of us will just blow that out of the water, that this new year that we're about to step into will be the best year yet. Let me pray, and we're going to begin to worship our Lord and Savior together today. Father, we thank you. Thank you for a video. We thank you for goals that have been met and surpassed. Father, I thank you for those who even will continue to give for our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Father, for every dime that is given, every penny, Father, that's given, will go directly to those missionaries around the world to help them to meet their financial needs so that they can stay on the field, Father, so that they can just share the gospel and build those relationships and impact a lost world for Christ. Father, thank you for all that you've done for us throughout this holiday season and what you will continue to do as we celebrate the birth of Christ, Father, as we move toward a new year as well. Father, just continue to bless this, your church. May we serve you well in all that we do. I pray today in Jesus' name. Amen.
How many of you have seen a movie rendition of A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens? Pretty much everybody. How many of you realize that that story is a reflection, a picture of the gospel? The first spirit makes him look back at his past and he sees his sin. The last spirit shows him your path to the grave if you do not change. And suddenly, Scrooge's heart was changed. And his exclamation was, I will celebrate Christmas every day of the year. New birth in Christ is a celebration that is not contained within 24 hours of December the 25th. It is an everyday celebration. And he is a gift to us for every single day of the year. And we're going to worship him this morning. We're going to invite you to stand and to sing. And these Christmas carols are to lift him up and to sing about him and a joy in your heart. And if you have not met him before, we hope that changes before you leave this building. But stand and join us as we sing. We will glorify the King of Kings. Sing this next Christmas carol. We use it as a Christmas carol, but it's actually written about the second coming of Christ. Joy to the world, the Lord has come, actually returned. Help us as we sing this great carol, Joy to the World.
And heaven and nature see.
Hark the Herald. Join us if you will. Great singing this morning. Sound wonderful. You can be seated. You've been standing a long time. Another great carol that calls all believers together to worship Him. So whether you're in this room or you're watching online, join together to worship Him as we sing, "Oh come, all ye faithful."
Saw a little sign this morning that said it's 364 days till Christmas, and some people already have their Christmas lights up. Y'all got that one. That was good. I wondered about that one, you know. man, Christmas, it's been great. It is fabulous to be able to spend time with our families, fabulous to be able to spend time with friends and loved ones and just to celebrate blessings. For all of us, there's been ups and downs throughout this year. Good things and bad things have happened, and that's just sadly, and you know, but just ironically, that's just kind of how life goes around all of us. But even in the midst of the ups and the downs, everybody in this room today, everybody that's listening at home online, we have been blessed. God has been good. And as bad as some of those dark days may have been, it could have been worse. And we could have struggled through it even more, and especially if we didn't have Christ by our side. And so what a wonderful blessing to know who we are, to know who is with us, and to kind of get ready for a new year. You know, when we think about a new year, it's always this idea of things happening, things changing. Things are just going to get better. It's just like a new beginning. And in the midst of that, so many folks have this idea of New Year's resolutions and all of those things. You may be a really big New Year's resolution kind of person. You may be a little bit more like me, and I'm just not, to be honest with you. My faults are my faults, and they're there not just in January and the start of a new year. They're there usually year-round. And so I don't need to wait to January to work on something. I need to start each and every day to just be what Christ would have me to be. But if there's anything in our lives as we get ready to start a new year, anyone that we ought to kind of model ourselves after, it would be Jesus. Just to be like Jesus. What does that really mean? For so many people, it means different things, and that's really why I want to share with you a little bit this morning, talk to you a little bit, and share with you God's Word a little bit this morning of what does it really mean to be like Jesus? I mean, we live in a world that there's all kinds of folks want to be like, and honestly, most of the people today that are the influencers of the world, they are influencers, but they influence in the wrong direction. They definitely do not influence others toward Christ or influence others in a way, in a manner that is ultimately Christ-like. And so for us this morning, the idea is what it would be like to be like Jesus. The scripture that I want to share with you this morning comes out of Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 10. I'm going to read all of the verses to you, but really that first little part of really verse 5, I guess you would say, is the one that I'm going to kind of hone in on a little bit today and share a few thoughts with you today. But Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 10 says this: adopt the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus. And I mean, there's a lot there. We're going to get to all of that in just a few moments. But he says in verse 6, who existing in the form of God did not consider equality with God as something to be exploited. Instead, he emptied himself by assuming the form of a servant, taking on the likeness of humanity. And when he had come as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Let me pray with you for just a moment. Father, we are so blessed to be able to be here this morning to worship you, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for every individual in this room. Father, I pray that, first of all, every person here today and those that are listening, I pray that we are children of God. That, Father, we know You, that we love You, that we have a desire in our hearts to follow You, to be like You. And, Father, I pray if there is anyone here today who is not a child of God, anyone here today, Father, who realizes in the midst of this message or even now Your Holy Spirit is touching their heart, is drawing them, Father, I pray that they will realize their need for Christ, their need to be like Christ and come forward today and be right with Jesus. Come forward today and, Father, ask You to be the Lord and Savior of their life. Call on You, Father, and I know that You will save them. But, Father, I also know many believers here today. And that, Father, it is our ultimate desire, I pray, to be more like You. Our ultimate desire, Father, to start from scratch every single day to be like Jesus. And so, Father, give us what we need as believers to follow You. Give us what we need, Father, to the strength and help and courage each and every day to be like Jesus. Father, thank You for our time together this morning. I pray that we never take it for granted. Father, I thank You for Your blessings. Father, they are just more than we can ever imagine. And Father, thank You for all that You do for us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, this morning I've just honestly just went down and made you a little list of ways that we need to be like Jesus. And of course, the scripture verses and the things that are all around that, I want to share those with you as well. And so let's just start from the top right here. I would like to be like Jesus, first of all, in love. When you hear that word love today, it says a lot. The word love, it means a lot of different things to a lot of people. You know, I look and my wife is back there on the back row and I say, Naomi, I love you. We didn't plan that, but I knew what was coming. Okay? My grandchildren are back there. I can say I love them. My children are back there. I say I love them. It's different. The love that I have for my wife is not exactly the same kind of love that I have for my children. The love that I have for my wife and children is not the same kind of love that I have for my grandchildren. I can tell all of you that I love you, and I do. I love you, but it's not the same. But let me tell you something. Jesus loves all of us the same. There are no favorites in the sight of God. There are no one that He loves any less, no one that He loves any more. God's love is efficient and sufficient to take care of each and every one of us, no matter who we are, no matter what is taking place. The love of Jesus is without discrimination, for God so loved the world. He loves those who follow Him just as much as He loves those who have rejected Him. God so loved the world. Man, listen, we can pray for folks. We can preach to folks. We can do everything humanly possible to help folks. But let me tell you this, here it is, bottom line. We will never win lost people to Christ until we show them that we love them. Until we show them that God loves them. Why in the world would a lost person want what we have if what we have is not love? Why in the world would a lost person want to come to church if they come to a church and they don't feel loved? Let me tell you something, folks. The first impression that you and I make when someone comes into our church building, it matters. It makes a difference. And oh, I want to encourage all of you, not just a few Sunday school teachers, not just a few deacons. I want to encourage all of our church family. When somebody walks into this door, you don't know them. All you have to do is love them. Say hello to them. Introduce yourself to them. Make them feel like Friendship Baptist Church is a friendly place. I think we do a good job at that. But don't ever take it for granted. Don't ever take it that, it was so-and-so will take care of them today. No, you get up and go see who it is. Don't let somebody else do your job, and your job is our job to love the way Jesus loves. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 says, above all, maintain constant love for one another. Above all, maintain a constant love for one another. Then he says, the latter part of that verse says, since love covers a multitude of sins. Wow. It really does. Not only from our perspective, but especially from God's perspective. God's love for the world has covered all sin. Think about that for a moment. God's love. Why did God send Jesus? He loves us. Why did God create us? He loves us. Why do we have an opportunity to spend eternity in heaven? Because He loves us. Every aspect of what God has done for us in some form or fashion, no matter what it is, can, I believe, be traced back to the idea that God loves us. And so, ladies and gentlemen, if we want to be like Jesus, man, we've got to learn to love others the way Jesus has loved us, to love them no matter what. Love covers a multitude of sins. That's true in our relationship with Christ, but it needs to also be true in our relationship with others. I mean, come on, moms and dads, how many times have we forgiven our children because we love them? You know, we may have even thought a couple of times, if I didn't love you so much, I wouldn't forgive you right now. Maybe so. But certainly, if anybody has a reason not to forgive us, it's our Father. It's all the sin in our life, man, really? But love covers a multitude of sin. We need to be like Jesus in our love. We also need this morning to be like Jesus in our humbleness. The latter part of verse 7 out of chapter 2 of Philippians into verse 8 says, and when he had come as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. Let me tell you something. The only way that you and I can be obedient to the Lord, the only way that you and I can truly follow Him, the only way that you and I can serve Him the way we are supposed to is if we must humbly come before Him. Humility does not mean weakness, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus Christ, our Father, is the creator of all things. John says, all things were created through Him, and apart from Him, not one thing was created that has been created. Man, we are living in an age of pride, self-pride that pushes us beyond anything else. We are proud of our possessions. We are proud of our stuff. We are proud of who we are. We are proud of what we look like. We are just proud people, and we must humbly come before the Lord. The Bible says pride comes before destruction. We need to be humble. I didn't say weak. I said humble. Ladies and gentlemen, if we can't bow down to God, who can we bow down to? And here's the idea. We have this mentality, well, I'm not going to bow down to anybody. I'm a man. I'm a grown adult. I know what I'm doing. You might in part of this world, but that has absolutely nothing to do with your relationship with Christ. Be prideful. I mean, you know, you do a good job at work. Great. Take pride in that. You do a good job in school. Wonderful. Take pride in that. Your grades are good, are amazing. Wonderful. Take pride in that. You've been top seller and top employee, wonderful. Take pride in that. But we're sinners. And we must humbly come before the Lord.
If we're going to follow Him, if we're going to be obedient to Him, if we're going to allow ourselves to be like Jesus, there's a humbleness that comes from us, that must come from us, to say, Lord, here I am, warts and all. Here I am, as terrible as I am. Here I am, Lord, because up to You, there is no pride in me. Lord, help me do what You want me to do. Help me be humble before You, O Lord. To be like Jesus in our love, to be like Jesus in our humbleness. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 says this. It's verse 14. It's one that's really important. Now, let me step back to the side and say this too. There's certain aspects of God's Word. When sometimes God's Word lists items, that list is there for a reason. And that the order of that list is there for a reason. You know, sometimes when your wife gives you a grocery list and, you know, you go there and you you get the list and you may get the bottom item first because you go down that first aisle and it's, you know, she wrote down bananas at the very bottom. When you go down that first aisle at the grocery basket, they're on that first aisle, right? Yes, they are. Been there too many times. I know what how the bananas are on. You know, y'all do too. Well, why don't you put those in the first line? Whatever. Okay. Doesn't matter for grocery list. But there are certain things in God's Word that does matter. There are lists and things that if we don't start at the top, we can't work. You know, you can't just jump to the bottom if you don't start at the top. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, I'm going to say it. You're going to know it. Most of you may know it by heart. But folks, this is one of those verses that you got to take in order. All right. If my people, you got to be Christians. He's talking to God's people here. So that's the very beginning. Called by My name. What are we? We're supposed to be Christians here. If My people who are called by My name, then He says this, shall humble themselves. What has to come first for God's people? We must be humble. Because we look at the rest of that verse and it says, and pray and seek My face and turn from my wicked ways. What we really like about that verse is, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. And we think, yes, Lord, forgive our sin, heal our land. And God looks at us and says, where's the humility? We got to start in order. And so if we're going to be like Jesus and the idea of being humble like Jesus, He says, those who are My people who are called by My name shall humble themselves and then pray. Humble yourself and then pray. Why do we pray first? Well, first of all, we need to pray first because we need to ask God what He wants us to do. You know, because most of the time we've got our own ideas. And if we really pray about it, God may just kind of change our mind mid-prayer. And if we're really open to that, I mean, God can do things there before we even get to the rest. Humble themselves, then and pray. Then it says, and seek My face. In other words, God, what is Your will, not my will? God, what do You want in this situation, not what I want? We all have our wants. We all have what our desires are. But we're to seek God's face in this. We're to be humble. We're to pray. Seek His face there. Turn from our wicked ways. Let me say, we all have wicked ways. All of us. Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, forgive me of my sins. All of these things have to happen first. Then, He says, I will heal from heaven. I will forgive their sin and heal their land. I know a lot of times you hear that verse preached and maybe it's on around the 4th of July or something like that. And it's preached about our nation and where our nation has gone and all of that kind of stuff. And I'll be honest with you, man, you know, our nation is definitely not what it needs to be, definitely not what it used to be. And our nation is not following this verse. We want to heal. We want God to heal our land, but we don't want to be humble. We don't want to pray. We want to take things out of order. And if we want to be like Jesus, being humble like Him, let's keep things in order the way we should. I want to love. I want to be like Jesus in love, be like Jesus in humbleness. Next, we want to be like Jesus in prayer. I mean, that's a big one, is it not? How in the world? How in the world can we be like Jesus in prayer? I mean, he's God's son. Okay? I mean, come on here. Preacher, what are you trying to do? What kind of expectations do you have for us? Well, I just want us to be like Jesus in prayer. Not condemning anyone here today or any other time. That's not my job. I'll talk to you about stuff, but you know, especially from the pulpit, and that's necessarily my job per se to condemn certain individuals, but I'll just throw this out there at you. How much time do you spend in prayer? You know, do you spend 5 minutes a day in prayer? 10 minutes a day in prayer? Let me ask you this. If somebody told you, and it's just a friend of yours, and y'all were talking, and they actually said, listen, man, I have built up my prayer life. I spend an hour a day in prayer. How many of you, I want you to raise your hand for this one, okay? How many of you would think that's awesome? That's big time. An hour a day in prayer? Some of y'all are just scared to raise your hand or something. I don't know what's wrong with you. An hour a day? Wow. Honestly, statistics tell us that most believers don't pray every day, is what most statistics tell us. And when we do, it's only for a few minutes a day. The average. Maybe we're all above average in this room. I hope we are. But think about it for a moment. To be like Jesus in prayer, Luke chapter 6 says, during those days he went out to the mountain to pray and spent all night in prayer to God. Now that's not just an hour. The Bible says he spent all night in prayer. Listen, you know, all night? Preacher, I get tired. Man, I want to go to sleep. I got to get up and go to work in the morning. I understand. What do we do? How are we like Jesus in our prayer? Here's what I like more than a time, okay? I don't want to put a time limit or a time effort on anybody's prayer life, but I do like this next verse. It's Luke chapter 11, verse 1. It says that he was praying, talking about Jesus, and it says this, in a certain place. So let me tell you this. More importantly, I think, than you finding this certain amount of time to be praying, I think you need to find a place of prayer for your life, wherever that may be. You know, we talk about prayer rooms, prayer closets. You know, it may be you may go to work and you may drive to work every day, an hour or longer to work every day. Listen, I used to drive. I was pastoring a church and delivering milk, dairy fresh milk, years ago. I got up and was at work at 5 o'clock every morning. I drove that milk route 4 days a week. You can pray all you want to driving up and down the road. Man, God listens. God knows. Only thing I ask is don't close your eyes. If you're going to drive and pray, just keep your eyes open. But other than that, man, pray. Find a place. Find something that's yours, yours and the Lord's, and pray. You want to be like Jesus. Find a place to pray. Jesus, I believe, had that place. He needed that place. God, yes. Man, yes. He was both. And he needed that time with the Lord. Not only to be like Jesus in our prayer, to be like Jesus in our faith. Another high hill to climb, right? I mean, come on, preacher. This is, you know, God's son. Talk about faith. Sure, we have faith in him. I love John 11, verses 41 and 42. It says, so they removed the stone. Then Jesus raised his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Now listen, he did this. He's saying this so that everybody around him can hear what he's saying, okay? He's not whispering this. I want you to know that. These words that he's saying here, he meant them so that everybody could hear this. Father, I thank you that you heard me. I know that you always hear me. But because of the crowd standing here, I said this so that they may believe you sent me. Man, Jesus had a faith. God, I don't care. I'm not worried about what other people, but in this instance, in this resurrection moment, he wanted everybody to know who he was. He wanted everybody to know what was happening, what was taking place. He wanted everybody to know that his faith, God, the one true God, was real. We're going to have faith like Jesus. I think it means this. Don't hide your faith. Don't keep your faith to yourself. Matter of fact, I'm pretty sure the Bible tells us we're supposed to share our faith. That if it's real in our lives, in our hearts, we're supposed to let others know about our relationship with Christ, about what our faith really is. Can we have the same kind of faith as Jesus? No, we know that. We can't be like Jesus in that moment, in that kind of way, but we can share our faith the way he did. I mean, here it was, an enormous, amazing event taking place, but all Jesus did in that moment was just kind of opened his mouth and said something. He wanted everybody to hear, hey, just thought y'all might want to know, I'll be going to church tomorrow. See y'all there. Hey, just thought y'all might want to know, I love Jesus. I hope you do too. I mean, there is all kinds of ways, ladies and gentlemen, that we need to share our faith. And if we're going to have a faith like Jesus, it must be a faith that we're willing to share. Not only to be like Jesus in our faith, oh, to be like Jesus in our service. Now, here's where it kind of gets down to us. Here's where it really gets to that nitty gritty idea, so to speak. Luke writes to us in Acts chapter 10. Verses 37 and reading from there, kind of a little synopsis of God's or of Christ's service. I think it's kind of neat to think about and read for a moment. So it's Acts chapter 10, beginning with verse 37. He says, you know the events that took place throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John preached. I mean, he's just telling the story. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were under the tyranny of the devil, because God was with him. We ourselves are witnesses of everything he did in both the Judean country and in Jerusalem, and yet they killed him by hanging him on a tree. God raised up this man on the third day and caused him to be seen. Not by all the people, but by us whom God appointed as witnesses. He ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that through his name, everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin. To be like Jesus in service. To the side this for a moment here, listen, if you are a child of God, if you here this morning are a child of God, you are here to serve Jesus. You are here to serve our Heavenly Father. In some form or fashion, find your place of service. Listen, you're still breathing, right? Please tell me yes. Okay, I don't want to be, I've heard of you folks who've gone through that before. I don't ever hopefully want to go through that. You're still breathing. I've had folks tell me, preacher, I'm an old person. I don't know why I'm still here. And all I can say is, well, let me tell you something. God has a reason for it. There's something you need to keep doing. Some kind of service you need to have in your life to serve Him. Things you need to do for Him. Find your place of service. Find your little niche. Find whatever it is that God wants you to do. Maybe it's a ministry within our church. Fine. Find that place. Be a part of that. Develop that. Grow in that. But let me tell you something. Even as a church member, there are other areas of service outside of our church. There are things that you can do, ways that you can serve the Lord necessarily outside of our church. That's okay. What's most important is service the Lord. And to be like Jesus, to serve Him over and over again. I've had too many times people have said, preacher, I have just nothing to do. It's all been done. Everything's been taken care of. No, it hasn't. Jesus said these words to His disciples. He said these words to us, His disciples. The harvest is abundant, but the workers are few. The harvest is abundant. Man, the field is white with harvest, but the workers are few. Kind of sounds like where we are in our society today, doesn't it? I mean, you go to a places and they got help wanted signs all over the place. You go somewhere and you want to sit down in a restaurant and they say, well, we can only fill half of the tables because we don't have enough folks to work. There's jobs everywhere, but the workers are few. Well, that's not any different per se, yet from a spiritual standpoint, the harvest is ready. Man, if there's ever been a time when this world needs Jesus, if there's ever been a time when our world needs revival, if there's ever been a time when we need to turn some things around, not worry about political situations, we better start worrying about spiritual situations. Our God, man, it's going to get bad. The harvest is there. He says the workers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out folks for the harvest. Well, folks, that's what we're supposed to do. We are the workers. And before Jesus left this place, He gave a great commission and He told each and every one of us as a follower of Christ to harvest. To harvest a lost world for Christ. Oh, to be like Jesus in love and humbleness and prayer, in faithfulness and in service. But one day this morning, if you are here and you are a child of God, one day you will be like Jesus in glory. That day's coming. For each and every one of us in this room. Don't know when the Lord's going to return. If He returns in our lifetime, we'll be changed in the twinkling of an eye. We'll meet Him in the air. I mean, it's going to be a glorious kind of moment. We will be like Jesus. If we pass away and it's 100 years or whenever Christ returns, we're going to rise from the dead. We're going to meet Him in the air. We're going to be like Jesus. It's going to be a glorious time for all of us who know Christ as the Lord and Savior of our life. There's going to be a time where in glory where we will be like Jesus. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Dear friends, I like that. Dear friends, John says, he's talking to us. He's talking to believers. He says, we're friends. Dear friends, we are God's children now. Man, we're God's children now. We're not God's children later. We're not God's children after we die. We're not God's children when we eventually get to heaven. We're God's children now. And what we will be has not yet been revealed. As awesome. I mean, I know the world goes up and down, but listen to me. As awesome and as wonderful as the world is today, to be a child of God, to know what our future holds, to know that we're not walking through life alone, to know all of these things over and over and over, it will get even better, he says. We are his child now, but it's not what it has yet been revealed. We know that when he appears, we will be like him. Man, I want to be like Jesus. We will be like him. So our job is this. Every single day from now until we are like him, our job is to strive to be like him. Our job is to do what we can to serve him well, to be like Jesus. Pray with me. Father, I do thank you for this morning together, our time, this fellowship, our love. Father, we are truly blessed beyond measure today. We thank you, we love you, we just praise your name. Father, if there is anyone here this morning who realizes that they have a need today of salvation, Father, they have a need today of knowing Christ as the Lord and Savior of their life, Father, I pray that when this invitation begins, that person will come forward. They will not leave this place today without Christ. And Father, I pray for believers that are here today. So many of us, I know, with a desire, I pray, Father, to be like Jesus. Help us, Lord. It's a daily struggle, something we go through every single day. And so, Father, I just pray that you will bless as only you can. Move in these next few moments together for your will to be done, I pray. Amen. I invite you to stand with me this morning, to come forward, to make a decision. The altar is open. Whatever you need to do here today, I invite you to come. Thank you.